Hi, friends, and welcome to another special Jackrabbit Insider. I'm Tyler Merriam, and it's great to have you with us. This week, we turn our focus to men's basketball at the Division I level. Scott Nagy's program was tremendously successful in D2 before falling on hard times early in the transition. The coach stayed the course, however, and multiple NCAA tournaments follow. This week, we highlight some of their most memorable games, beginning with perhaps the most improbable victory in program history. The Jackrabbit men's basketball program found out just how difficult the transition to Division I can be in their introductory year, 2005-06. SDSU started the year 1-7 and won just 9 games that season. Steve Holdren, the team's second leading scorer the previous year, tore his ACL in November and he was lost for the year. Two other players were suspended, draining an already thin roster. So Scott Nagy turned to John Stiglmeyer's football program. Chris Wagner, Mike Steffen, Brock Campbell, and Glenn Fox all joined the team for the last 9 games, with Wagner and Steffen playing important roles off the bench.
I mean, that was such a ragtag group that we had.
On February 18, 2006, the 7-17 Jacks hosted 15-10 North Dakota State. The Bison were 30 points better than SDSU in Fargo the previous month, and featured a group of freshmen that would turn into the most successful class in their program's history.
I think most people were just hoping to get through the night there and stay close or something in the game.
SDSU went ahead early on a Ben Barron slam, and the teams traded leads with 6 ties in the first 7 minutes. Then the Bison kicked into high gear with a 12-0 run, and everyone assumed the fate of the Jacks was sealed, but not on this night. Andy Kleinjohn scored off a turnover. Barron followed with a jumper. Mike Olone, who made only 6 threes all season, and Matt Cadwell each hit from long range. The Jacks were within 3 at halftime and would take the lead early in the second half. SDSU had another run in it early in the second half, trailing by a point. The Jacks rattled off 9 straight, with Olone scoring twice on putbacks. And the rest of the half played out in a game of seesaw. NDSU closed within 2. Mackenzie Casey hit a 3. 7 minutes left. After NDSU scored, Wagner, the football player, with the offensive rebound and score. 5 remaining. Ben Woodside got the Bison within 3, but Jose Frias responded. 4 to play. The Bison closed within 1, and Casey hit again. 2:30 to go. Up 1 with a minute left, the Jacks turned it over, but Frias regained the possession and hit 1 of 2 free throws. It would be up to the defense. 13 seconds on the clock and the Jacks buckled down. Brett Winkleman got a good look from 3. Wagner, the football player, won the battle for the rebound. Miraculously, SDSU had won, 67-65.
Fortunately, you know, Chris was able to come out and play with us, and I remember at the end of the game, he got a rebound, and there were probably 3 seconds left, and the officials just like quit officiating, and he was all excited that he got the rebound. He started running with the ball. He traveled. They didn't call that. We were very excited to win that basketball game.
And so I think the combination of actually playing a competitive game, actually winning the game, and doing so with a couple of the football players as well is something that a lot of people are going to remember.
That was not the first hair-raising win the Jacks had at home that year. 5-1 Denver entered Frost Arena on December 10, 2005. SDSU led for all of 25 seconds during the first half as the Pioneers built up an 8-point halftime edge. That lead ballooned to 16 with 14.5 to play. Then the 3 started to fall. Andre Gilbert, Matt Cadwell, Eric Hine, an 11-2 spurt that had kept the game somewhat in doubt, but the Pioneers led 67-57 with 2.5 left. Then Hine hit a 3, but it stayed a 7-point game with 30 seconds left. Andy Kleinjohn forced a turnover, and Gilbert followed Kleinjohn's miss. Denver's David Crummer could have sealed it with a dunk. Instead, Cadwell on the other end made it a 2-point game. Denver missed 2 free throws in the final 15 seconds, and the Jacks had a chance to force overtime, trailing by 3. Kleinjohn dribbled, pulled up, and somehow found the bottom of the net. Despite Denver's furious and perhaps proper protests, the shot counted. Overtime. The Pioneers again jumped in front and took a three-point lead with 20 seconds left. An offensive rebound led to Cadwell's fourth three of the night and a tie game with five ticks remaining. Hine took a gamble and tried to draw a charge. It worked. SDSU would have a chance to win it, and Cadwell would not disappoint. An 81-78 SDSU victory. Coming up, the men take down both Iowa and Iowa State on the road. That's straight ahead after a trip inside state.
Honestly, when you first arrive here, you're like, this is really big. But you take a half hour walk around campus, it's nice and compact. It's into one, you know, it's a square, basically. My name is Corey Sheekwin. I'm from Elk Point, South Dakota. You know, talk to my dad and my uncles when they come. They don't even recognize campus anymore. You know, they see one or two old halls, but as far as the new union and everything, it's a really exciting time to be here. I'm in the Pride of the Dakotas drum line, which has been one of my favorite parts of SDSU. Marching in the Hobo Day Parade is one of the greatest memories. My favorite piece of SDSU apparel, my Pride uniform, of course. They can be hot sometimes, and then they can be cold at sometimes, but they got the Pride written on the back. I grew up on an 1,800-acre corn and soybean farm. The world population's growing, and that means that people are kind of starting to take over more of the farmland that's out there. So, like I said, less farmland, but we're also going to have to feed more people. And so the challenge is, how do you do that? It's a big responsibility, and I'll be a sixth generation on my family's farm. So part of that, you know, I kind of feel kind of my heritage and everything. It makes me kind of really proud to go back to the farm, and I'm really excited to take on that opportunity and to grow our family business. Thanks to SDSU, I am ready to achieve the goals that I have just in the ag sector, and also the goals I have for my family's farm, kind of for the future, and helping not only South Dakota, but, you know, kind of feeding the world, as we like to say.
To me, sustainability means being able to feed the world in the future.
We need to produce more with less.
It's knowing that our soil is going to be in better shape this year than it was the year before.
It's about caring for the land.
It's about passing it on to the next generation.
It's about doing the right thing.
I'm Jeff Lochner.
Steve Halverson.
Al Muron.
This is Farming.
Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. For powerful calls. For breakthrough calls. For professional calls. For tough calls. For unexpected calls. For expert calls. Make the right call. Choose the experts. Choose Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine.
This portion of the Jackrabbit Insider is brought to you by Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. Expert care when you need it.
Welcome back. The Jackrabbit men's basketball team has certainly made itself known in the state of Iowa, knocking off the state's two biggest schools. It's very difficult to win on the road in Division I, in particular when you are transitioning. The Jacks suffered 17 straight defeats away from Frost Arena, entering the December 23, 2008 contest at Iowa State in Ames. Greg McDermott and the Cyclones were looking for an easy pre-Christmas win, but it was anything but jolly for the red-clad hosts, as Scott Nagy and his squad played the role of Grinch. The first half was taut, with neither team leading by more than five. The Jacks stayed close by shooting 5 of 10 from deep. Garrett Callahan's bomb beat the buzzer as Iowa State led 32-30 at the break. In the second half, the SDSU defense was stifling. The Cyclones managed only 8 field goals, shooting a mere 28%. SDSU out-rebounded the Big 12 opposition and forced 16 turnovers. Big man Anthony Cordova leaned on the Cyclone posts, scoring 3 times in 2 minutes as the Jacks went in front. And every time the Cyclones threatened, SDSU would respond in kind. Up by 2 with just over 10 minutes remaining, Garrett Callahan hit 2 free throws and followed it up with a beautiful drive and finish. Moments later, Sargent hit from the parking lot. The Jacks were in front 53-44 with less than 8 to play. SDSU hit just enough free throws to withstand a late rally, and Kai Williams' dunk was the exclamation point. Sargent posted a double-double in his home state, 18 points and 10 rebounds. Williams did as well, 12 and 10. Cordova scored 17 on 7 of 10 shooting, and Callahan contributed 11. A monumental win for the Jacks. 2 years later, November 14, 2010, Fran McCaffrey was making his debut as head coach at the University of Iowa, and his premiere was televised nationally. The Hawkeyes anticipated a coronation. The Jacks had other ideas.
The black uniforms were out, and it was a chance to kind of leave a mark in the region, to step up and say, okay, this is a good team. So there was an amped up, there was an atmosphere, and there was an amped up energy, I remember, about the team.
Iowa led by 6 midway through the half. Then Braden Carlson scored on consecutive possessions. And Clint Sargent showed off first his leaping ability, and then his range. Chad White and Nate Walters got into the act as well. The Jacks closed the half on a 10-0 run and led by 9 at intermission. In the second half, Iowa responded and led on a couple of occasions. Then the Walters show kicked into high gear. A sophomore point guard scored a game-high 25 points and dished out 9 assists. SDSU forced 18 turnovers, and Dale Moss pounded the final nail into Iowa's coffin. A 79-69 win, and the second of 6 straight victories to begin a campaign that saw the Jacks go 19-12.
Assistant coach Rob Klinkefuss coming back out, he turned his phone on as we were packing up to leave, and it just kept dinging and dinging and dinging. He was getting text message after text message. It was a monumental win, and everybody had noticed it.
While those two are significant, one could argue SDSU's 2 most impressive wins away from Brookings came later. We remember SDSU's trips to Washington and New Mexico when the Jackrabbit Insider continues.
Perhaps the greatest pitcher in SDSU history, Trevor Schulte is this week's Jackrabbit Legend, presented by Legend Seeds. The southpaw from Montevideo, Minnesota, won 5 games his first 2 seasons in yellow and blue. He lost each of his first 2 starts his junior year, but would not lose again for 14 months. He went 10-2 in 1993, adding a save while compiling a 2.25 earned run average. Opponents hit just 198 off Schulte, who earned All-America honors as his squad won a school record 39 games. SDSU won 39 again in 94. Schulte went 11-1 his senior year with 100 strikeouts in 85 innings. He won 21 consecutive games over that 2-year stretch, an NCAA record. That still stands. His 26 wins and .839 winning percentage for his career are program records, and he's second in SDSU annals with 226 strikeouts. Pitcher Trevor Schulte, a Jackrabbit legend. This Jackrabbit legend is presented by Legend Seeds, your regional seed leader.
Get ready for the Hefties Fan PhD Tip of the Week, encouraging you to get up, get loud, and get involved, and give the Jackrabbits a hometown advantage.
This year was fantastic. I got my best yields ever.
Record yields start by putting the best seed in the ground. At Hefty, we not only pick the best genetics and traits for you, but we have the most stringent seed grower specs in the industry. That means higher yields for you.
We're Hefties, and we're big on the farm.
Hefty brand soybeans, agronomy, answers, yield.
When we are on one of those famous Frost Arena runs, let's get on our feet and cheer and make some noise. Let's force our opponents to call a timeout and keep cheering through the break.
This week's fan tip was brought to you by Hefty's Fan PhD, helping Jackrabbit fans go from good to great. The Jackrabbit men were a contender for the Summit League title in December of 2011, and Nate Walters was already an all-conference candidate. But for Walters and the Jacks, their time in the national spotlight began on a Sunday afternoon in Seattle. The Pac-12 Huskies featured multiple players who went on to play in the NBA. Scott Nagy and his staff took notice during pregame warmups.
As we looked at him, we just kind of looked at each other, and our thought process was that we hope we can keep this thing close.
They did plenty more than that. After Washington got the opening bucket, SDSU took the lead for good with a 9-0 run. the Jacks made each of their first 7 3-point attempts, with Griffin Callahan, Nate Walters, Chad White, and Jordan Dykstra all hitting from long range. The Jacks held a 51-33 lead at the break and maintained a double-digit margin the entire second half. Five Jacks posted double figures, but the big story was Walters. He scored 34 points on 10 of 20 shooting, seemingly getting to the rim at will. He made 13 of 16 free throws, corralled 5 rebounds, and handed out 7 assists without committing a turnover. The Jacks won 92-73, ending the Huskies' 32-game home non-conference win streak.
As it was going on, and as it was clear that SDSU was not a fluke and that they were probably going to win that game, then the focus of what's wrong with Washington turned to, like, holy smokes, the visiting team, the upset team, has become part of the story now. It's not just that the home team got beat. It was that, who are these guys? And that was the game that where Nate Walters and company announced themselves to sort of a national audience.
As impressive as that win was, SDSU did one better 12 months later. But the story of the SDSU-New Mexico game doesn't begin in Albuquerque, but rather 9 days earlier.
That was one of the most unbelievable road trips of all time, you know, and being out 9 or 10 days and going in and beating Montana. And Nate was still hurt. You know, Nate was not 100%. We beat Montana in overtime. They hadn't lost a home game there, and, you know, they had a nice home winning streak there, and we go in and win.
SDSU beat Montana 68-67 in double overtime in Missoula. Braden Carlson denied Kareem Jamar in the 50th and final minute to seal the Jacks' ninth win.
And then we go down to Belmont, and we're terrible. You know, we hung in there for a while, and I think I might have been even tied at halftime. We were close. Second half, I mean, we were just not good. Very flat.
That game was tied at 37 with 12 minutes left, but the Bruins scored the game's next 18 points. And SDSU shot only 27% in the 76-49 rout.
And then the next day, having to get up early and sit around at airport all, you know, till about noon or 1 or 2 and then get on that bus. And
due to weather issues in the Midwest, the Jacks could not make their connecting flight. So the team was forced to bus from Nashville to Albuquerque, a drive of 18 hours covering 1,225 miles.
I just remember getting to Albuquerque and going to practice that night, and the guys just were hadn't had enough of each other. I mean, we had a very, very, for an hour, you know, just very chippy. Everybody was on everybody's nerves. We just had enough. We'd spent too much time together.
And with all of that, the yellow and blue took the court at the Pit, where 15,278 fans and the 16th ranked team in the country were licking their chops.
I had no feel before the game, before the New Mexico game, how we would play or how we would do, and it was amazing how well we played.
Much like at Washington the previous year, the Jacks fell behind 2-0. And much like the game in Seattle, the three-point barrage started shortly thereafter. Chad White, Braden Carlson, Jake Biddle, and Walters all contributed as the Jacks built up a 12-point first-half lead, and New Mexico would get no closer than 3 the rest of the way. A battered and bruised Walters would not be denied. 28 points, 7 assists, and 5 steals. Dykstra added a double-double, and the Jacks beat a ranked Division I team for the first time in program history. SDSU 70, New Mexico 65.
That one's defined as much by the bus ride as the win. And then that became part of the story, and that got national attention because you have to bus from Nashville. And who can bus from Nashville after getting blown out by a really good Belmont team? You're not supposed to then bus across the country and beat a top 25 team, and that's what happened. Whenever the Jacks have a clunker or a bad road trip, people will say sort of like, but remember New Mexico, and say, well, it could happen.
Friends, I rode that bus alongside the squad all 1,200 miles from Nashville to Albuquerque, and their performance that Saturday in the Pit is one of the most remarkable things I've ever witnessed. Up next, the SDSU men reach the summit when the Jackrabbit Insider continues.
Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. For powerful calls. For breakthrough calls. For professional calls. For tough calls. For unexpected calls. For expert calls. Make the right call. Choose the experts. Choose Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine.
Listen up. This is the time, this is the place, and this is Ford F-150, the truck that goes toe-to-toe with your life. Made of high-strength, military-grade aluminum alloy, it pulled the highest safety rating the government can give. And with Pro Trailer Backup Assist, it's like having your head on a swivel, pal. So load up your crew. This is the time.
Now get up to $10,395 in total savings or lease an F-150 for just $279 a month. Visit your local Northland Ford dealer today.
How did we become the region's largest independent seed company? By taking a very simple but powerful stand. We will sell no seed that we wouldn't be happy to plant on our own farm. Peterson Farm Seed. Stand tall.
The Jackrabbit Insider is brought to you by the Hefty Seed Company, Agronomy, Answers, Yield. Your local Northland Ford dealers. Visit northlandford.com or your local dealer. Sanford Orthopedics and Sports Medicine. Expert care when you need it. The University Bookstore. Shop now at jackrabbitcentral.com. South Dakota Corn. This is Farming. Proud sponsor of the South Dakota Showdown Series. And by South Dakota State University. Be great. Start here.
Our look at some of the greatest men's basketball victories in Division I has reached its crescendo, the Summit League Tournament. March 7th, 2009 was the first day of the inaugural Summit League Tournament in Sioux Falls. The Jackrabbit men were the seventh seed against three-time defending league champions Oral Roberts.
That was one of those days where nobody knew what to expect because it was a new situation for SDCU, it was new for Sioux Falls, it was new for the Summit League. Oral Roberts, they were the best program in the league.
5,481 turned out to support SDSU's upset bid. It was the culmination of a long journey transitioning into Division I for Scott Nagy and his program.
I mean, so many things that we had been through, and finally, you know, having this opportunity to play in a game that actually counted in the postseason was just, even before the game, was highly emotional for me, and I know that it was for our players.
The Jacks appeared jittery early and fell behind 6-0. Then they rattled off 11 straight and led much of the game. The Golden Eagles turned the Jets on in the second half with a 15-0 run and were in front 57-51 with 2:05 left. Clint Sargent hit a pair of free throws, and Griffin Callahan's steal and score cut the deficit to 2. After 2 ORU free throws, Dale Moss scored to again make it a 2-point game. Then Kevin Ford had a chance to pound the final nail in the coffin. He couldn't convert the dunk, but the Golden Eagles still maintained a 3-point lead. On the Jacks' final possession, Garrett Callahan scored and was fouled. His free throw tied it, and Dominique Morrison missed at the buzzer. The crowd was in a frenzy as the Jacks had forced overtime. After Moss and Williams scored early in OT, Callahan took over. He scored a career-high 30 in the game, and this three-point play put the Jacks in front. He would add 2 free throws, and SDSU forced a pair of misses in the final seconds. The glass slipper fit for Cinderella SDSU, 72-69.
Probably one of the most emotional games for me, and I remember after the game going out to see my family, and my son, who was a freshman at the time, my oldest son, was like in tears. I remember thinking how hard this has been on my whole family.
The Jacks made the tournament semifinals in both 2009 and 2011, but it was a different story in 2012. As the 2 seed, there were lofty expectations. After running through IUPUI and Southern Utah, the Jacks matched up with the overlooked Western Illinois Leathernecks and their grinded-out style. And this was for everything. The Summit League title, and an NCAA berth.
We were just so tight and just could not get anything going. Western, you know, was very good defensively.
They were tight and you could see throughout, and yet they sort of willed shots over the rim. Even the big shots they made, it felt like they crawled in or they banked in. Like, it was not what they'd meant to do.
SDSU led 24-23 with just over 4 minutes left in the first half, but did not score another field goal until Walters finally hit with 14-19 left in the game. That 10-minute drought helped the Leathernecks build a double-digit lead. But then it was State that turned on the vice grips, holding Western to only 6 points in the final 13 minutes of regulation.
We were really good defensively, and we had to be, particularly in the second half, because we were down 12. And when you're down 12 to Western Illinois, that's like being down 30 because of the way that they play.
Nothing went as planned for the Jacks in that game. They'd gotten breaks in getting that matchup. A lot of people felt like that was to their advantage. There were some upsets, and SDSU avoided that. And here it looked like maybe they were going to have an easy time, and they just didn't.
Tony Feagan, Walters, and Griffin Callahan all found the net in the Jacks' final surge. Chad White's three with just under 5 minutes remaining brought SDSU within two. And trailing 44-42 with 29 seconds left, Callahan willed himself to the free throw line. He hit both, and the Jacks and Leathernecks were headed for overtime. White hit an improbable three with 2:43 left, but it was the lone senior, Callahan, who would strike the dagger. His tray with 1:27 left provided a two-point cushion, and the defense would do the rest.
And then, you know, just it came down to one defensive stop at the end, and I can still see, you know, Braden Carlson sort of holding on to that ball for dear life and kind of not knowing what to do. And there was sort of this reaction, did this just happen? And it did, and it happened again the next year. And, you know, that single day, I think, in all the big moments of the transition, you could make an argument that's the breakthrough day for any program at SDSU.
The next year, it was rival North Dakota State standing between SDSU and a second straight league title. But unlike the nervous energy of the rookies in 2012, this time it was a calm team that was sure of itself.
There was less emotion. It was more just about the business of preparing for the game and getting ready for it. And I think that it helped our players too, that we had been in that situation before, that there was less emotion and we were more businesslike, and we played pretty good in that game.
The Bison were worthy of being in the championship and fought tooth and nail, but the Jacks simply were not going to be denied. Walters shined as bright as ever. 27 points, 6 rebounds, 6 assists, and 4 steals. Jordan Dykstra had 18 points. Tony Feagan added 12. Braden Carlson was a perfect 3-for-3 from deep and also grabbed 6 boards. A sellout crowd of 6,544 in the Sioux Falls Arena screamed their lungs out, and they were rewarded for their efforts as SDSU handed their northern rivals a 73-67 defeat and claimed a second straight Summit League crown. Boy, what an atmosphere, the Summit League tournament at the Sioux Falls Arena. Thanks for joining us this week, and remember, for more on the history of SDSU athletics, visit us online at gojacks.com. For all of us here in our Jaeger Media Center studios, I'm Tyler Merriam. We'll see you next time on the Jackrabbit Insider.